it or not, but I'll at least start with what I did. So I'm Jason Clock, born, raised, live, run a company here in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, just a few minutes down the road. Is everybody from the area, or are we from like all over the place? All over the place? Yeah, that's so cool, awesome. I lived in Elizabethtown for 2 years in 2006, actually a few years, 2006 to 2010. I rented a house down here after high school for my father. I actually fixed up the property and then moved back to Harrisburg. But I was always kind of a Harrisburg guy, but been on campus before, saw a couple concerts here throughout the years. When I was 20, I think I dated a girl that went to E-Town College at one point. So I've been on campus before. It's a fun school for sure. So thanks for having me. So what my company is it's entertainment. It's live events. It's a lot of fun. A lot of cool work that goes into it. So weddings is the biggest division of our company. When I was 12 years old, I got two speakers at a neighborhood yard sale and pretty much started growing my company from there. I was always in the music, sound, electronics, and really just wanted to play loud music and have a lot of fun. So I did that in high school for everyone's sweet 16, everyone's parents' anniversaries, party, birthdays. And then when I was 17, DJed a wedding for a friend at the Lingolstown Fire Hall. And that was my first wedding. And I was like, man, weddings are awesome. Like, I was able to charge a little bit more. I was home a little bit earlier. And because, you know, nightlife and stuff like that, typically bars end, you know, at 2 a.m., weddings end at 10 or 11. So all the math was like, I got to be a wedding DJ. I think I can really do this and make it happen. So from there, I really started to just do some online advertising myself. I had built like my own website in 2004, 2005 at that point, was really into trying to learn the internet in its not beginning stages, but I guess it's early stages for advertising and business, and really tried to capitalize on that at the time. It was really innovative for like a young mind at 17 years old. And really just kind of self-marketed, self-promoted. I was solicited by a lot of entertainment companies and DJ companies at a young age that really wanted me to work for them, but I always was just kind of, I wanted to do my own thing and see how far I could take it. A little bit of pride, a little bit of challenge, just to see what I could do. Throughout high school, like I said, that last year, senior year, I went to Dauphin County Tech in Harrisburg, which was the technical school, for the second half of my high school years. And I accomplished all my credits and was actually able to go on a co-op program. So at 9 a.m., I was done with all my school for the day. And I worked for a cell phone company out of Carlisle selling cell phones. I did like the store manager, but it gave me the flexibility in outside sales to also grow and do this. So I was working during the weekday hours when all my friends were still in high school, and then on the weekends I was DJing, or like I said, I ran live sound and played drums too to kind of fill in the gaps, but was always in like that entertainment and talent. Post high school, I chopped away at college and did some continuing education, but I never was able to commit to leaving the area more than living in Elizabethtown from Harrisburg, since it's only 20 minutes. But I never wanted to commit to schools I looked at, such as Shippensburg and whatnot, because it was far away. And I felt like I was, for me, going to college, I was going to miss out on some local opportunity, or going to a remote college out of the area. Was going to cause me to miss out on some local opportunity that I was developing, getting calls and being able to be booked or do whatever I wanted to do when it came to like the wedding and the DJ stuff. So I continued to push forward and stay local. Had a couple outside sales jobs and account management jobs intermittently that I learned a lot of the corporate structure and the corporate world, a lot of on-site training. So as techie and advanced as I was with self-marketing, Clock Entertainment, DJ services and all that stuff, the company I worked for in 2008, to remind you, was sort of the year where smartphones were becoming a real thing. July of 2008 is when the iPhone first came out. So that was kind of the year where businesses and the corporate world was becoming okay with cell phones being used for communication, like email to your phone. It's not what it is now, but advanced texting, that type of stuff, it was just now starting to be okay. The company I worked for in 2008 would not let me use my cell phone, an email address to communicate with clients. I pretty much had to go like door to door at like 21 years old. which was the most miserable job in the world, but the best experience in the world, because it forced me to learn how to communicate, forced me to learn how to work hard and work smart, because the sooner I got my work done, the sooner I was able to work on clock stuff, and obviously that's where my heart was. So just a wild experience. From there, I was leveraged to get an opportunity to work out of a company in Delaware. Believe it or not, sold water coolers and coffee brewers, which was an interesting product to sell. But didn't really matter what I was selling. The fact is that I was selling and putting numbers on the board and learning about the corporate structure. That was the job where I learned the most about corporate structure, because I was in charge of anything west of Philadelphia at 22 years old. 21 years old still, I'm sorry. The other job, I was 20. At 21 years old, I was charged of anything west of Philadelphia that was an existing account or new business that I wanted to self-generate for revenue. I worked out of my office here in Elizabethtown, or my home office in Elizabethtown, and literally throughout the day, like, I would have their laptop here and then Clock's laptop here, and I would double dip and go back and forth with phone calls and development from there. That year was 2009. 2009 was the first year for my self-business where it was no longer just me. So everything prior to that was, it was me. I was doing it all. I was hustling. I was taking the calls. I was selling. I was booking the jobs. I was DJing. I was the talent. Whatever it was only Jason. That was the first year that I decided to hire an employee and create what's known as a multi-op. So now I was starting to develop a multi-op DJ company. Which means on any given night, mostly Fridays and Saturdays, we could book multiple jobs and be duplicating, I'll go with that word, duplicating our services on an evening to be able to have multiple shows going on the way that I wanted them to go on. And it was really cool how we were beginning to redefine what wedding entertainment was. It wasn't just showing up with two big speakers and playing loud music. The way that we do things with coordination, and it's really developed today to being involved and now the level of production that we bring. So that leveraged me into making this full time. I really did that for a couple of years. I grinded in that atmosphere, working for two companies, pretty much two full-time jobs. I didn't have children yet. I was in my early 20s. And I literally just worked probably 60, 70 hours a week doing both. Now, granted, some of those hours were the fun stuff. That's when I was DJing. That's when I was at a wedding. That's when I was at a dance or whatever it was. But it was still putting in that time. All my friends were like, hey, what are you doing tonight? You know, it's a Saturday night. And I was like, we're going to go out. We're going to do this. And I was like, well, I'll get there to the party once, maybe midnight or 1 a.m. when I'm done tore down and the party's pretty much over. So it was always that was just the style that I chose to live. But I have no regrets. I had a blast creating what we did. Before I talk any further, and I didn't test drive this, so we're going to see what happens. I think we got the audio and the video working. I want to show you guys a video that I made, or I released a year ago. It took us about 3 months to put together. I'm really big on marketing. I'm really big on branding and sharing the story and the journey within my industry, with all of you here in this room and times like this. So this is a video that I put together called The First 10 Years. So kind of the first 10 years of the grind and being in business and that type of stuff we had released last year. So check it out. I will restart it. I'm going to get this to work. I'm just going to make sure that the sound preferences. Headphone port. Does anybody know if there's anything special that I have to do up here for the audio video purposes? Anybody in this room know anything about this? I know about it for what I do for a living, but it's a little different. Let's try it again. Without the audio, this video is just not going to be as fun.
And I immediately responded with deep.
Sorry, let's start it over. I'll turn it down a little bit. Here we go.
I remember driving somewhere with one of my best friends from high school, and my best friend said to me, If you were to win $1 million, what is it that you would do because you would no longer have to work again? And I immediately responded with DJ. Ever since I was a kid, I had a love for music that I wasn't able to explain. I tried playing many different instruments, and I was successful at some and not at some. But once I realized that DJing was a thing, it felt to me like I was playing every instrument. And as I had grown up, I had realized that I could turn what I was doing into a means to make a living. 30 years old, I still want to be a DJ, but in addition to DJing, I now have such a love for producing events. In recent years, I've learned that it's so much more than playing the right music. It's about helping a couple or a client with their special moment or their special message, and helping anyone else in the industry with a similar mission. Throughout the first 10 years, I've had many mentors, and it is my hope that I can also be a mentor to somebody. Everybody always asks, Jason, what is that one thing that you have done to help make you successful or that you would recommend somebody else to do? All I can think is consistency, and all I can think is sincerity, and all I can think is heart. I'm doing what I'm doing because I love it. Every day I wake up trying to figure out how I can make my dreams a reality. Some days have more challenges than others, but when you're working with passion, and you're working with energy, and you're working for all the right reasons, it makes those challenges easier so that you continue to move forward. The first 10 years were filled with many sacrifices. Sacrifices I'm so glad that I made because they got me so much further in life today. Those sacrifices have put me in a position where I can DJ, where I can produce an event, where I can run a company, where I can spend time with my family, and I can wake up every day truly loving what I'm doing.
Significant amount of balance in that video, which I had loved. So my friend Matt Stanball helped me produce that. My favorite part was like going back through like family footage and trying to find the stuff as like a kid. It was pretty cool. It was a fun video to produce and release. So went full time in 2011 and gave my resignation to that sales job I told you guys about. And in that, it was awesome. They were like, yeah, right, go start a DJ company. And I'm like, yeah, watch me. I did, and now it's funny. When I was in outside sales, one of the coolest things, it's kind of a, I don't know, it's fun, so I'll share it with you. When I was in outside sales, I mean, you're grinding. You're a 22-year-old kid, 21-year-old kid, just knocking on doors, trying to make a living, trying to turn a dollar over into your name. And, you know, you always hear no's and rejection. Why, for some reason, had always, like got fired up on those, because then I was like, well, if they say no, I'm just even more excited for the person that says yes, or like, you know, when they convert it over. So, all, you know, knocking on doors, trying to sell, you know, won a lot of accounts, and I was really successful at it. But there were some that said no, and like, of course, we get frustrating. Those are some of those same accounts now that want my business as a business. So I always like to bring that up, you know, when 10 years later, 8 years later, like, man, you know, I'd love to give you the sale, but, you know, when I was on the other end, you guys didn't give me the sale. But I have a lot of fun with that. It's kind of fun, the, you know, the people who can sometimes give you that fire, you know, when you're getting told no, when you're getting told, instead of making it discouraging, I kind of turn it into like encouragement and fire from that point. But so I went full time in 2011. My only source of income was now up to me. I worked out of my house still in Harrisburg, had like a little side office in the home, and then in my garage stored all the gear and had everything there. So my neighbors loved me. On a Saturday night at 11:30, there'd be four or five DJs rolling into my driveway, dropping off all the gear and lights and all that type of stuff. Same thing for Friday and Saturday. My garage was our first warehouse. And then in the office during the week, I would invite couples over for appointments, and then of course did all the sales, the video editing, the website, the marketing, all myself still, because I had the time to do it then. In 2012, we got our first office space, and that was a really cool feeling, connecting a phone line for the first time, having the security company come in, and signing a lease, you know, that you put in really your house and everything that you were able to have so far in life up at stake for something that you believed in so much about. And in that first office space, I then hired our first employee. So a big motive behind that first office was I couldn't have like another full-time employee work for me like out of my home, like out of my basement. And I didn't want them to work remote because I wanted that control over an employee to be able to be a manager. So in that first office, hired my first employee. For me, I chose that sales was first. I figured we'll figure it out. Let's just get things booked. Let's get things sold. A term that has been used in my education and mentorship and upbringing is book it and cook it. So get it booked and then we'll figure it out. Because I always knew that I was credible with my heart, that I would never promise anything that I couldn't figure out. So we ended up selling and booking and increased our business by like 330% inside of 6 months, just having two people sit in that office inviting. At that time, it was mostly weddings, and you'll hear about what we do now. It's not just weddings, but couples into the office, you know, every evening. There was 5, 6, 7 couples coming in for appointments Monday through Thursday. And we booked a lot of business and really put us on the map for South Central Pennsylvania that year in 2013. Came springtime, we realized that now we needed gear and all this, everything we sold, we now needed the product. So we ended up getting that and then realized that our office wasn't big enough. So inside of a year of a 3-year lease, we had to figure out a way to get out. And then we currently reside where we reside now. We've been there for 5 years. We just expired a 5-year lease, which that was the big lease that shook me up the sign, because you're talking now a commitment 5 years ago of an annual commitment of, you know, $50,000 that you just have to, just as a place to sit. That's not an investment in marketing. That's not $50,000 going into gear that you can rent out. That's just a hard cost that you just have to eat just to have a place to sit. And in addition to that, we now have another warehouse where we have all our gear as well. So it's definitely been a journey. But that 2012 point pushed us to grow out of that space. So these are some significant landmarks. And 2012 was the office. 2004 was my first wedding, by the way. 2008 was the year that I'm like, what in the world am I doing? Like, I'm 21 years old. Why am I not pushing towards what I love? And I described that earlier when I was doing the sales stuff. 2011, October 24th is when I went full time, and then 2012 was the landmark of when we got our first office space that August. 2015, between 2012 and 2015, lots of trial and error, but never in front of a client. So we were very strong, and I was really good at training and discipline to my team that clients and couples were getting delivered and deliverables of a very high quality wedding entertainment service, very professional for the area. We completely redefined what that was. So as a kid and attending weddings in high school for friends or family, you know, a wedding DJ was, you know, someone who just did this part-time, someone who just kind of went out on the weekends, played records for some beer money or whatever, side money or education money. I don't know if I can say beer in here. Sorry about that. But that's what it was. It was the talent. It was the band mentality, you know, play music for some side money and deliver and then leave. It wasn't really a business. It wasn't really a structure. It was just something that someone did. You just called a friend who would play some music. And that wasn't enough for me. I wanted to turn it in and use my business drive and use my hustle drive and create something out of it that could be tangible. So we were redefining it by showing up in suits with nice gear, clean gear, being a coordinator, having a planning meeting, paying attention to, you know, how we taped down cables or how we presented our banquet table with our equipment on it. It didn't look like a rock concert from 1972 with smoky speakers and bad-looking gear. It was very nice and clean. It fit the atmosphere. And that was really turning a lot of heads from people from venues of just that tender, loving care that was being put into something. It was a redefine of really the definition of what should be expected. And anything in business, any business that you look at or see, I didn't know that I was doing that at the time. I was just doing it. But when I reflect and look back at it, like any time that you're able to redefine something or redefine an expectation or create a definition for like what should be happening, and people like that new definition, and people are now used to that definition to the point where they can't go back to what it was. When you look at other businesses and other products out there that we're using on a day-to-day basis that didn't exist 5 years ago or didn't exist 10 years ago, they exist now because that's what they did. And that's probably a really powerful point. So we were doing that from a client standpoint. Another thing that was really cool that I would never be able to predict And it just really helped in our favor. Is we perform off-site. We go to venues. I'm sure, if raise of hands, who has been to a wedding reception in this room at any point in time in your life? But probably everybody. If not, you've watched a TV show or you've seen it on Instagram or something from a wedding. You go to venues. There's wedding venues. When you are getting engaged, you're getting married, you choose a place to have that wedding. We are not a wedding venue. We go out on the streets and get hired to go places. So in central Pennsylvania, in 2011, there were roughly 50 to 60 wedding venues that existed in a two-hour radius of Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. Today, in 2019, there is 260 wedding venues that exist in central Pennsylvania. So thank you, Lancaster County, for making my business better. But I couldn't predict that, but the best part was is that me having the guts to go full-time when I did, when no one else was full-time, when no one else was ready to handle that type of business, my company was. I had DJs on deck. I had teams ready to go. And there's no way to know that timing other than just to know when you have that gut like instinct like in your stomach that like, why am I not doing this full-time? Like, it's just there. Like, you should never fight a gut feeling in business. And that's where I sit, and I stand very strong to that, because had I fought that gut feeling any longer, I wouldn't have gotten far enough ahead to be able to handle I wouldn't have the supply for the demand of the local industry to be able to handle that. Now, since then, we were the only full-time company back then that was doing that. Because the market has grown, there are multiple other full-time companies that like to copy yours truly, but that's okay, I did it first. And because of that, that has actually helped actually keep a good plateau with a little bit more of a gradual growth, not just to our company, but to the industry. The type of growth that the wedding industry saw here in Lancaster County, Dauphin County, and York County, which is pretty much the surrounding one-hour radius of where we're standing and sitting right here, can't really go through that again. That was something that just happened the last 5 years, that 5 to 6 years that has just been, like I said, good timing. So from a gut feeling perspective, if anybody ever has that, whether you're running your own business or not, like just in work, like whether you want to go for something, whether you want to do something, I'm living proof that because I did that, I had really good timing with our industry and business. Another thing too is that I knew my worth and I knew my value for myself. And for my company, I really pushed hard on the price structure of the local region as well. So I mentioned before kind of like what DJing was, and that was a couple $100 to come do a wedding, a few $100 to come do a wedding, whatever it was. You know, here we were triple that entering into the market when no one else was charging anywhere near that. So. That's the whole like Steve Jobs mentality. Although their product is going down in quality, at first it was good stuff. But Steve Jobs, if anybody's ever read about him, that was kind of a joke, by the way. If anybody's ever read about him, you know, he was always more expensive than Microsoft, but he knew his worth and he was sticking to his guns. And now, if you don't have a Mac, people look at you like you're funny. Like if you get the green text coming through, like, wow, I can't talk to you. Like it's not blue. We've wired ourselves like so into that product, but that's something that we did as well at Clock Entertainment, was we really pushed that threshold to like what you should be paying. Because of that, our competitors make more money, because we did that for so many years and wouldn't back down when we had the supply, when they didn't. So, okay, they're calling other companies that are less expensive, but they're not available. We're more expensive. Now all of a sudden we're planting the seeds and getting more work than they are because we had the supply, even though we were more expensive. And now as the industry has turned and plateaued some, everyone's pricing has increased to get caught up to ours, which allows us to now still be the most expensive and continue to charge more as well. And it doesn't always mean that we're making more, of course, from a revenue standpoint, but it allows us to stay ahead of the curve and have a budget for things that they may not. Marketing, new services, the latest and biggest thing that's going to come out that's going to increase weddings or live events, because we have a better revenue structure or we weren't scared to go for it, we can probably be able to afford or get into something first. Has anyone seen like a live photo booth at an event? Like a mobile photo booth, you print the pictures, you put it in a memory book, or you get the take home. Now there's a lot of digital ones out there too that you'll see them out and about, you know, at a restaurant or maybe just digital only, and it texts the photo to you right away and stuff. We were, though, one of the first ones to get into that into the market as well in 2010. It's the same reason, you know, we were the first ones to start advertising, like photo booth and then different things with lighting as well, which is really cool. So 2015, weddings were rocking. Weddings are great. Weddings are growing. And our office staff is growing. Our team of DJs has been growing. Event assistants to run photo booths or lights or help us move the gear in and out of the shop and all that type of stuff has been growing. And now what I realized is I have a warehouse full of gear that only goes out 2 days a week. You know, $500,000, $1 million worth of gear that I've invested in, my company's invested in. It's only going out 2 days a week. Well, we got to solve that problem because I got great gear that could work every day out of the week. So we decided to enter into what's known as the corporate and live event market. And that is not weddings. That is meetings and events. That is sales conferences. That's targeting the big businesses out there, nonprofits, organizations, associations that are having things for a full day, a half day, or an entire week long at a convention center or a hotel where they're inviting anywhere from 50 to 500 people, you know, from most of the work that we do, occasionally get ones in the thousands, to come to some form of event that needs content delivered. They're going there for education. They're going there for an annual meeting or a quarterly meeting. They're going there to have a business or something deliver content to them. A content as in, you know, presentation, a fancy word for presentation. So we began to enter into that market, providing audio, providing lighting, providing content management and solutions, which has really grown our business to the point where we now, instead of growing vertically, in one category, we've now been able to broaden a horizon growth in multiple categories of business, which is giving us the opportunity to now, as we've gotten into that corporate production, we're staying on a cutting edge with weddings too, because now we're bringing a better level of equipment and production to our wedding receptions because we had to learn that to get into corporate. So right now we sit at 8 full-time employees. In our office, we have 3 dedicated to weddings, 2 both, and 3 dedicated to corporate events currently. And that's your during the week workers. We have over 50 people on payroll right now. And last year we produced over 500 events, about 350 of which were weddings. And then a little under 200 were your corporate live event stuff. And weddings are, you know, one-day events, and then the corporate live events, we did some week-long conferences, which was awesome. We did daily stuff, nonprofits, galas, really gotten our hands in a lot of cool stuff. Booking talent, bringing talent in, speakers in. One of the coolest things we did was bring like a Cirque du Soleil act in for an evening dinner for a client. It's been a lot of fun. So, and that first video showed me perform a lot. This is the challenge of being a business owner. As you begin to run out of time for things that you love, or begin to run out of time in general, because just the business needs now more hours per category of work. So over the last couple years, I've stepped down from performing as a wedding DJ, which is bittersweet. I used to perform while I did everything else on average 80 to 100 events a year, which was mostly weddings, which is almost every Friday, Saturday, Sunday. And in addition to that, I was running the company during the week and everything along those lines. I'm now going to do like maybe a dozen this year. And I'm also working corporate events during the week as well. I'm the lead like coordinator person and then, you know, doing everything in the office. Every time that the company would grow or get to that threshold or I would feel like I was out of time, over the last 10 years, specifically from 2011 on, anytime I would feel like I'm out of time to do this, I'm out of time to do this, or not having as much fun with this task anymore, I would always make lists and I would have, you know, what do I still love to do? What have I lost a little steam for? Like, what do I really not like to do? And that would always be my next employee. And that's how I really grew the company, and that's how I knew what to hire next was what I might be losing a little steam for, because I had to now find somebody who that's all they wanted to do for the business. And hiring as a small business too, sometimes that was 2 categories. Sometimes that could be 2 major things. You know, for example, our one sales guy is our lead talent person, which means he trains the talent, he solicits for the talent, he finds the talent, he's their support during the week, whether it be music or gear education and continuing training on lighting and stuff like that. But then he also sells weddings and does our booking. So he kind of does two things. One guy is like all sales and like business stuff. Then I have an admin who I drive nuts every day because she just does whatever we need to get done. She's call her our director of events. And then I have two people in the warehouse who just love the gear. They fix things, they make things work, they do cool stuff and tweak it and make it look cool for elementary terms about gear, if you will. So that's pretty cool. I want to show too, so today that's where we sit. I have another video is what I was going to say that I wanted to show you guys. Today where we sit is kind of split. We have a lot of great, exciting things on the horizon for next year. I know that not everybody's local, but last year my company and myself really got put on the map with a lot of cool opportunities. There's a group called Central Penn Business Journal here in Harrisburg, and they produce events throughout the region between Lancaster and Dauphin counties. And they did a top 50 fastest growing companies, which means that you have to submit all your tax returns and like write pretty much a thesis on like why you should be chosen. And they ask you all these questions and drill you and stuff like that, which is good. And we came in at 48, which is pretty cool because I'm sitting in that room with like, you know, multi-billion dollar companies. And I'm just like, you know, this is that was pretty humbling. The Harrisburg Regional Chamber does this Catalyst Boards every fall, and they look for people who are out in the community. And I personally won Entrepreneur of the Year last year from the Harrisburg Regional Catalyst, which was great because, you know, by at least 10 years, sometimes 20 years, I was the youngest person, you know, sitting in that room, which was really, really cool from, you know, people who got awards and stuff, which is another thing, too, that, like, someone told me as like a real young, you know, you guys aren't kids, 21, you know, when I was 21, someone was like, you always want to be the youngest person in the room, and like I still try and do that. I always want to be, you know, in business when you're trying to grow, when you're trying to be hungry, I always wanted to kind of know like the least amount of stuff whenever I was in the room. Like I know the less that the group of people that I'm sitting with. Go to eat at an event and you see an open seat at the table, like I always tried to, you know, stereotype to the fact that maybe I would know less than everybody at that table, or I'd be the youngest person at the table. I just always try and position myself for conversation to always be learning and always be growing is what kind of is behind that mentality. Let's take a break and like watch a couple more videos. So this one, I believe, is our corporate one. Before the videos. Again, really big on marketing, and I just love having stuff clean. I love having things just look much better than the competition all the time. And this is one of our team photos from 2017. We've gotten into this theme where we're always trying to find murals to take pictures in front of, and being a Harrisburg-based company, we try and do it around the city. So this is one that's located in downtown Harrisburg. I thought that was a really fun one. This is the majority of our team as well. Always clean cut, always, you know, looking sharp whenever we do events, and that's the full scope from corporate to wedding DJs. Everyone's kind of mixed in there. Simple things too, like gear cases, everything is branded when we go to an event, but not obnoxious. You know, we don't want to be unprofessional. So my DJs, we don't put, another thing that like the back in the day, you know, 10, 15 years ago, you had like a lot of the, you know, like part-time people hang like a rickety old nasty looking banner at like a beautiful $20,000 like wedding venue. So all my guys too, you probably saw it in the video, we just do simple stuff like this to let people know who we are. And with social as well, literally during like wedding receptions, like the dance floor is popping and like I'm getting tagged in on stuff. And it's like, that's free marketing. Like anytime someone's adding you or tagging you or, you know, this is a bit of a stretch, but like photos from the wedding, like this is in the background of like, you know, photos from the wedding, but not obnoxious, like just nice and clean. So branding is a big thing. For me to always find a way to market without like being obnoxious, but always want to politely know like where what we are and what we do. This was a really cool concept. I'll wake up in the morning and have like a crazy idea. So I'm like, I'm gonna go buy thousands of like used records from an old record shop and then we're going to throw them all up in the air. And then I didn't think about people getting cut and hurt. But this picture turned out awesome. So a couple employees were a little upset at me, but we got this photo, and that's what I care about. And at the end of the day, they care about that too. So this is a really cool concept. This is a mural at a bike shop in Harrisburg. Third year. Is it second? Right by the Broad Street Market? Yeah. What I love about this is this mural. Personally, I'm really into health, well-being, peace, all that stuff. So this mural is the way it was. I was described is it's talking about like recycling into something that flourishes. So that's why you have like the gray over there is supposed to represent what could be trash, and then like recycling it to turning into a beautiful space. It's kind of the background story. So I like personally connected to that mural too, which is pretty cool. So. Yeah, now I have thousands of broken records. But it was a really cool concept, really cool idea. We're always trying to find things to be edgy that has to do with like sound, music, because even with the live event and the corporate stuff, there's still, I still think this is a good marketing piece for that. So this here, I didn't touch any settings, so I think it's going to work. There's a corporate video to give you an idea of like what we do now to manage a full week-long conference.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the SRWA 2016 conference. My name is Jason with Clock Entertainment. Please enjoy this brief recap as it demonstrates how we can help partner with you for your next conference or event.
So in that video, you saw the tech and the gear and all that stuff, but you also saw content management. You saw a very punctual schedule that each element throughout the course of the day had to be different. They were a roofing company, so there was education in that main room. And then you saw like probably roofing products and looked like to be outside in a tent. That was their demonstration area as well, where they had to do it outside because like the chemicals and like the roofing stuff that they had. So we had audio out there, video streaming content, and then there were breakout rooms in that hotel that had separate education going on. All was going on at the same time. I was a coordinator with the headset piece on, making sure that everything was not only just working, but everything was done punctual. We were hired for the whole week so that the business could be the business. They could work with their clients, they could do what they needed to do, and not have to worry about if the slideshow was going to work, if their speaker that they hired was going to be there, so on and so forth. And then, of course, they had the evening entertainment. You probably saw a quick shot of one of our photo booths that they wanted to do. And then, like, that Cirque du Soleil act was the final evening. Like, thank you for coming to our conference. Let's have fun. Let's let loose. Have a good meal type of thing. So a lot of cool stuff that we did and we produced in-house, which has really brought us to get there from learning that discipline from weddings. It's kind of neat. Like, from a wedding reception, there's such a high expectation. Like, you never want to mess with a bride. Like, you got 2 seconds or 1 minute to do it right, and that's it. And you've got to learn how to be able to deliver that in a very positive, uplifting manner. So we did, and I did, and I was just wired that way to be able to handle that. From a corporate standpoint, you know, for so long, at least in our region that we found, you know, oh, it's just a screen, it's just a projector, it's just a speaker. But when we bring in that attitude that we learned from, like, the wedding side of things, like, they really appreciate it, and they're starting to see value in it, which is really cool. This is a fun one. This wedding was in 2017. I can't believe it's been that long already. 2017 was my last, like, really full year of performing. So this one was a lot of fun. We had the lighting. We have a CO2 blast, which is really cool that you'll see. If you want a clock wedding, this is what you get. Or no, this one's me talking. My bad.
Jason, and I'm the founder and owner of Clock Editor.
My talent
DJing
intro. My bad.
Is all I know. Running a business has been a blast the last few years. But one thing that I really love is producing events for couples and clients. I love taking music and creating energy, and then mirroring the energy to production elements for life-lasting memories. Ever since I was a little kid, I was around music through my family, and it was just embedded in me. There's something in the clock genes that I have to work on Saturdays, and it has just been a spark in me, and it's been since almost day one. And I knew that DJing was one way that I could use music to make people as happy as music has made me. My favorite moment of a wedding or an event is accomplishing something the client had their heart set on that no one else was able to do. And that moment is now a memory for the rest of their life. I love what I do because I consider myself a positive and high energy, happy person. And when I can use, whether it be production elements or whether it be music, and bring the happiness out of them, let them forget about everything else in life, and just enjoy those moments at events, that's why I love what I do. I get such an excitement out of working with couples, out of working with families, out of working with clients and companies. That's what keeps me going. That's what I love, what I do, is bringing out the excitement and bringing out those specific moments at people's events. In addition to DJing, I'm obviously running the company as the owner and the CEO, but I still love the opportunity to entertain, MC, produce, and work with couples and clients throughout the course of the year. So please consider myself for your special event. I would love to be your DJ. I'd love to be your event producer. I'd love to be your guy. And even if you don't choose me, I'm overseeing it all, so I will make sure that each couple gets the TLC that's needed for 100% and more success of an event.
That's the video that gets emailed to people or is embedded into our website. So we made a lot of these videos. I use them in presentations and, you know, occasionally when someone's in the office, but a lot of times before they even pick up the phone, they just sat and watched that because I no need to duplicate the effort. It's like the more information I can give them before they even call, then it's just the less time you know that we spend. So that video was made when I still use it. Like I said, I still perform. But that was kind of like the talent side. That first one was the first 10 years more in the business. That's the one that if someone wants to hire me to produce their event or perform for a wedding, that's typically the video that is shown. And we made those for all of our DJs. And we're working on doing educational stuff with our techs that we do for corporate events and whatnot. So what's next? Continue to hire a couple new employees, full-time employees that I want to do. And really continue to push that corporate market. Like I mentioned our weddings a lot. We've had substantial growth, and that will continue to grow, you know, a good percentage each year, and I want to continue to do that. But right now I'm trying to get the corporate side to catch up in revenue and event count so that we can kind of be split 50-50 here, hopefully over the course of the next year. We continue to get really involved in the community with organizations, which I think is really important. And we continue to get more and more tenure out of each employee that we hire. So instead of them being here for a year, we have people who are now celebrating 5-6 years as DJs, which is almost the better half of the life of it being a real company from 2011, which is really exciting. We do offer, like, this is really important stuff as well. We do offer a 401k match. We offer, you know, really good health benefits and coverage, long-term disability and everything like that that any other business I feel like should be offering their employees. And it's crazy that in my industry and even the small business community, that's not really offered out there. But it's really important for me to invest back into our employees with things like that as well. We do quarterly lock-ins for educational events. Every full-time employee has the opportunity to go to a conference in our industry. They just have to give me a report on it. So good standing reviews. They go to one conference every year, which is typically in Las Vegas or somewhere a lot nicer than central Pennsylvania when it comes to weather and things to do. I love central Pennsylvania. It's not a pun against our area and whatnot. So it's pretty exciting. I think at this point, I love to take questions. I kind of thrive on questions. And I don't know where I'm at with timing. But probably have a little bit more than 15 minutes for questions, and that's good because I can't really answer questions about this type of stuff in like 2 minutes or 3 minutes per question. My man is eager to go.
Yeah. So what is your guys' like competitive advantage compared to your competition?
So that continues to change, to be honest with you. So I mentioned at the beginning, one, we were available and they weren't. Well, that's obviously a competitive advantage because they can't even be hired. Now our competitive advantage is still full-time. There's still a lot of part-time out there. Our other competitive advantage from a business perspective that my team talks about, my sales team and bookings team talks about, is all of our talent that would be producing a wedding or an event is an actual employee, W-2 employee, like any other job. So in my business, it's not uncommon to have a subcontractor, a 1099. I'm sure you guys understand, you know, what I mean by the difference of that. With an employee, you have a lot more control over your training, a lot more control over their discipline, how they act, how they fly your flag, how they run your brand. And that's a big competitive advantage. We also do things with teams and just the way that we coordinate, you know, not just show up on the day of. We have a lot beforehand work. Because like I said, the more beforehand work you can do, that 2 seconds or 1 minute, you know, that client needs to be punctual is just going to be all the ever easy, because you really have one chance to do it right. Ask me anything about music, life, business. Yeah.
How did you invest in all the equipment at Cliff?
What's that?
How much was all the equipment? How did you?
A lot.
Yeah.
No, I think I know where you're going without that question. Yeah. So because I worked full time, I never had to take out a loan until last year. I never had to take out, we were self-funded. I put so much back into the business in those first few years that I was double dipping my efforts and energy, although, you know, losing my 20s and doing the things that 20-year-olds do, I was always putting my money back into the business. So I had another job that could put the food on the table and I could eat a little bit more than peanut butter and jelly. I could pay the car payment. I could pay my mortgage with that other job. And I literally would just use everything from that company to make sure that our employees were paid, of course, and back in the marketing and build a savings account, you know, on both sides, a personal savings account, a business savings account. And with that, we were really self-funded. I took off a couple short-term loans, you know, like 30 or 90 days for products to get like maybe 5 photo booths in, you know, and go all out with that or whatnot. It came to a point that 3 years ago, we activated a business line of credit, which means, again, short-term cash flow assistance. We're seasonal in central Pennsylvania. So this is the time of year in first quarter. We'll tap into that line of credit, and then, you know, by May or June, chop that back off so we don't hold that long-term debt throughout the course of the year. Last year was the first year with our corporate growth that I elected to take on a 3-year termed loan for a substantial amount of money to get some really nice big boy equipment to make the competitors cry. So that's how we did that. And I'm really fortunate that because I double dipped for as long as I did, and I just really did it to that gut feeling, like kept me up at night, to that gut feeling. I mean, the gut wasn't a financial thing. It was just like, you know, what are you doing? But because I double dipped for so long, each year we could spend you know, decent amount of money on gear without anything that really carried over to another year or another quarter when it came to debt, which saved us a lot of money. You had your hand up too.
Yeah, what are the key characteristics you look for when employing somebody? Say like the top three.
Top three. You have to have similar or equal energy of myself. number two, it's all on the pre-communication to me, actually before you get in the person. I love the way that, like, you know, you get an email. Everything, so much is done on your phone now. It's not uncommon for someone to apply using a device and then attach something or what have you. I look for simple things like, the way their email comes through to my inbox, does it still say like msmith@gmail.com because they were too lazy to type Mary Smith in the settings? You know, little things like that. Following instructions up front. We will post things every spring. We're getting ready to do this here in the next month. We blast for jobs like photo booth techs, like event assistants, because it's seasonal. We need the work. And then you always get a few people to stay on, and then some people go back to college or whatever and do that type of stuff. If anybody's sticking around this summer, hit me up. We need good people. But following instructions. So when we put stuff online, it'll be like, do not call, do not DM us, you know, when we're advertising on Instagram and Facebook. Like, email, attached resume, and cover letter. Well, if there's no cover letter, delete. If there's no resume, delete. If they DM us, delete. If they call, delete the voicemail. Like, seriously, like, we're that harsh. Like, you follow instructions. Now, it's different that if they email us and do the right things and then follow up with a phone call, or email us and then follow up with a DM, and the DM is like an excitement touch. Like, I just sent you all of our stuff, or I just sent you all of my information as you requested. I can't wait to hear from you. Like, that's a hustle point that, like, will actually turn us on to that person. And then third, it really has to do with schedule and discipline. So we will ask a lot of probing questions in a meeting about their weekends and, you know, their hobbies and things like that, because this is a job that's really appealing at first to a lot of people. But then when you realize that you're giving up 25 Saturday nights over the course of the year, some people can really struggle with that, whether they have responsibilities with children, maybe they're in civil service and they're also a firefighter. You know, you're gonna kind of fight two things that you like, and we don't want to put somebody in a position of too much sacrifice. So that's something to consider as well when we meet people. So it's kind of like the top three: energy, charisma, and discipline, and then of course like your schedule for what we do. Why are you applying? I'll come back to you since you already asked one. These two guys just like flew their hands up. Yeah. So I can answer that question from an entertainment standpoint, a performance standpoint because of music. And then I can also answer that standpoint from like a business owner and how that affects. So start with the fun one. Music is, the way that we distribute music to our team has completely changed. When I first started in those early years, I literally would have piles of burnt CDs ready to go for the teams with their equipment like every Friday. Or do it on Mondays, whatever it was. Like, I'd hand them a pile of burnt CDs, and that was part of what I was doing during the week, was like digging for like the latest remix. Like, my team's got to sound the best. So like, we didn't make the remix, but we're the ones playing it. And whatever the track was. So that is all digital now, which saves time. In fact, a lot of my team now, we don't even distribute music anymore. They all have their own subscriptions and licenses to things. And when you get into this type of business, radio, DJ, or whatever, you're not just using iTunes. There's like hundreds of different websites you can pull from for like DJ stuff. And they all kind of have their own stuff from that, which is pretty cool. The way we communicate with them, we communicate with our team via a text program. So it's a nightmare to communicate to 40, laugh with me, don't take offense, millennials, several different ways. So now we just text them all, and that's like a means of communication. When they need to know something, like submit your timelines, or their team meeting is going to be here, or whatever it is. So we have a whole program now that integrates that. From a business perspective, working remote is a lot easier. We have more and more people wanting to meet over the phone via FaceTime. So we do have less in in-person meetings, which of course saves time. That technology is more available. Our phones is like crazy. Like I can from my phone, I'd never do it. I could probably DJ a wedding from my phone at this point, but I can talk to, I can see a lead come in. I can talk to the lead. I can send a contract from my phone. And then I can follow up and like I can literally do everything from my phone between the apps and the softwares that we've invested into our company, which is huge. Obviously, you like to be in an office environment so you don't make mistakes, you don't move too quickly, and you give them the proper customer service. But when I am traveling at a conference or that type of thing, you know, it's cool to have that there. And it really has increased our client care and our ability, you know, because we're hungry and our competitors might not be as hungry. It allows us to get back to people right away. It allows us to get back to our staff right away. Allows us to document. We take pictures of everything we do, every wedding we do, every corporate event we do, we take pictures. So then when you got that one bride that like, her mom's a little driving her nuts, but we're the ones that are going to take the call and get the complaint over it. So it's going to be like, hey, you guys didn't have the uplights set up. Oh, well, you know, here's Josh's pictures of all your beautiful uplights around your room. We're good. So there's like the safety net and like business side of it too, which is pretty cool. And then from a marketing standpoint, you know, Instagram Live or Instagram stories, like everything when we're, you know, weekends and summer, it's a really cool account to follow. Got a lot of cool stuff going on. What's going on, man?
From when you started until now, what would you say?
Love this one. So I will be happy to talk about my most significant mistake, but I don't know if I would ever change it, because if I wouldn't have made that mistake, there's so many more successors that I've experienced because of it. I was so hungry and eager to grow, which you guys have probably caught that vibe, that I hired some friends, and I hired people that were close to me that I thought were going to be friends and I thought were going to want to participate in the journey. And they started to do, you know, like hand out their own business cards underneath the Clock brand. They started to do some things that were not up to my standards. And I would have conversations, but I never cut the ties because I was so hungry, because I felt like I needed them. And then one day I realized, you know, this is my business and I get to choose who I work with, so forget this. And there was one night in June, I just told this story yesterday. In June of 2014, on a Saturday in mid-season, I waited in the warehouse. I didn't have a wedding that night for whatever reason. And I waited in the warehouse, and everyone was coming back different times, like 9:30, 10, 10:30, 11, 11:30. And there was five people who needed to go and just didn't get it. And they were kind of in a clique. They're now a competitor. And I swear to God. And so I literally let each person go individually by shock and surprise to all of them right then and there. So, and the first time, you know, the first person at 9:30, it was like the first person I fired. I was like shaken, you know, and they were a friend. Second person, shook, you know, by the time fifth person, I was like, just leave. You know? So it got a lot easier. And I'm not trying to water down the process of HR and the certain things you have to do when you need to let go an employee by any means, bringing the comic relief to it. But that was my biggest mistake. But because of that, it led me to become such a better manager and a leader. It led me to become such a better hirer and I realized that you should put more efforts in like your hire versus like, you know, hire slow, fire fast. And I was hiring fast and didn't know how to fire yet because I was 25 years old. So that was that's the biggest mistake, biggest lesson. Yeah.
Do you see your company going like all over the country, or do you think you want to keep it like Pennsylvania here?
Great question. So currently we do events throughout the country. Not as much weddings, although I think we have one wedding booked in Colorado this year, which is pretty cool for like a friend. So we have done corporate though, because that's a little easier to like pack a box truck and then bring that there. The navigation pieces of it, there's more of a budget for that type of thing. So corporate, we're already servicing nationally, which is awesome. Weddings, it's the way our marketing is and the way I know this market, I'm really kind of probably going to be a regional wedding company. If anything, might break out into a nearby city. Probably Pittsburgh before Philly, because Pittsburgh culturally is a little bit more similar to central Pennsylvania. Philly culturally is a little bit more similar to like New Jersey and New York. So that's probably, we'll probably go left before we go right. And then corporate, the biggest thing that we're looking to do is either acquire a company that's on their way out with our young energy and marketing and then get some really good employees that understand the tech side of things. Because there's a lot of people in my business right now where I'm the youngest player on that corporate side, and I don't know where that'll lead us. But I have a lot more work to plow down here in Central PA before I would put a brick and mortar building out there somewhere. But from taking and servicing clients, there's a lot of businesses located in Central Pennsylvania that are national companies that we can go on the road with them. Where are we at on time? Was that it? Was that an hour?
Yeah.
Flu.
Yeah. It's not.